Look at this, the sea and the sky. Both are blue, a beautiful color that, if you've noticed, is pretty rare in nature. For example, we don't have any blue-colored animals. By the way, we've already made a video about why blue is so rare in nature. And I've put the link in the description for you. Also, that video is from one of our other team channels, so don't forget to subscribe to it so you don't miss our videos. But even more fascinating than the rarity of blue in nature is the fact that ancient people couldn't see the color blue. First things first, when I say they couldn't see blue, I don't mean their eyes were broken or anything like that. No, it's much more interesting. Imagine you're in a garden full of vibrant flowers. You see reds, yellows, greens, but no blue. Strange, right? Here's a mind-bending question. Do colors really exist, or are they just in our heads? I know, deep stuff. Colors are basically light waves that our brains interpret. Without a brain to process them, colors don't technically exist. So, how did our ancient ancestors know what colors were? The answer lies in their language. Language is like a window into how people perceive the world. The more we talk about something, the more it becomes part of our reality. For instance, let's take a look at ancient texts like Homer's The Iliad. The color blue is never mentioned, not even once. Mind-blowing, huh? But other colors like red, yellow, and green? Yep, those were there. Actually, the word black was used 170 times, white 100 times, red 13 times, and both yellow and green 10 times each. But not even once was a word used to describe blue. Here's a fascinating study. Researchers discovered that languages develop color names in a specific order. First come black and white, then red, followed by green or yellow, and finally blue. So older languages might not have a word for blue at all. Now, this is where it gets really interesting. If you can't name something, it's hard to fully grasp it. This is a basic principle of language. Without a word, your brain struggles to process the concept. It's like trying to explain what a frindle is if you've never heard of it. But why blue? Why not purple or orange? Well, the answer lies in nature. Blue is surprisingly rare in the natural world. Water is blue, right? Actually, water is clear. The sky is blue. Sure, but only when you think about it. Many ancient societies lived in regions where the sky was often dusty and brownish. Blue simply wasn't a significant part of their environment. In contrast, colors like red, think blood, yellow, think fire, and green, think plants, were much more prominent in their daily lives. Also, many of the natural materials we used to create blue dyes weren't available back then. For example, lapis lazuli, one of the main sources of blue pigment, was rare and difficult to mine. It wasn't like they could just pop down to the local art supply store for some ultramarine paint. To give you an idea of how rare blue was, ancient Egyptians valued lapis lazuli as highly as gold. They used it for jewelry and amulets, but rarely for everyday items. It was literally worth its weight in gold. Even in ancient literature, the use of blue is almost non-existent. For instance, the famous Greek poet Homer described the sea as wine dark, not blue. This isn't because Homer needed glasses, it's because the concept of blue just didn't exist for him. Moving on to another culture, the ancient Chinese had a word for blue, but it was rarely used in their poetry or art. They often described the sky as black or white, depending on the time of day. In fact, the ancient Hebrews didn't have a specific word for blue either. The Bible mentions the color in the context of sacred items, but everyday descriptions are devoid of blue. It wasn't until the development of international trade that blue dyes became more accessible and the concept of blue spread. Here's another fun fact. The Himba people of Namibia still don't have a word for blue in their language today. Studies have shown that they find it challenging to distinguish between green and blue. This just goes to show how much language shapes our perception. So, what does this mean for us today? Well, it highlights just how powerful language is in shaping our reality. It's like that old saying, if a tree falls in a forest and no one is around to hear it, does it make a sound? Similarly, if we don't have a word for a color, do we really see it? Interestingly, this phenomenon isn't just limited to ancient cultures. Even in modern times, there are languages with limited color vocabularies. For example, in some remote cultures, there are only words for light and dark, instead of specific color names. On the flip side, some languages are incredibly rich in color terms. Take Japanese, for instance. They have different words for various shades of blue and green. This allows for a much more nuanced perception of color. Another intriguing aspect is how the introduction of new colors can change a culture. When synthetic dyes became widely available in the 19th century, they revolutionized fashion, art, and even social status. Suddenly, people could wear vibrant colors that were previously unimaginable. Let's talk about some cool science behind how we see colors. But before that, if you haven't liked the video yet, please give it a like now. The human eye has three types of color receptors called cones that detect red, green, and blue light. But interestingly, the ability to see blue might have evolved later in humans compared to other colors. This evolutionary twist could explain why ancient cultures didn't prioritize blue in their language or art. Speaking of evolution, did you know that some animals see colors very differently from humans? For instance, dogs are often said to be colorblind, but they actually see a limited range of colors, mostly yellows and blues. Birds and bees, on the other hand, can see ultraviolet light, which is completely invisible to us. Our perception of color is also influenced by cultural factors. In some cultures, colors carry specific symbolic meanings. For example, in many Western cultures, blue is often associated with calmness and stability, while in some Eastern cultures, it can symbolize immortality or spirituality. These cultural associations can influence how we perceive and use colors in our daily lives. Now let's fast forward to more recent history. The color blue didn't become widely recognized and utilized until the creation of synthetic blue dyes in the 19th century. Before that, natural blue dyes were rare and expensive, limiting their use to the elite or for special purposes. The invention of synthetic dyes democratized color, making blue accessible to everyone. The famous artist Pablo Picasso went through a blue period from 1901 to 1904, during which he painted predominantly in shades of blue. This phase was marked by somber subjects and a melancholic mood, demonstrating how the availability of blue pigment allowed for new artistic expressions. Blue has also played a significant role in science and technology. For instance, the discovery of blue LEDs revolutionized lighting and display technologies, leading to the development of energy-efficient screens and lighting solutions that we use every day. Now let's get even deeper. Are there colors out there that we can't see and don't even know exist? I'll explain the answer to this question while you like the video. The short answer is absolutely. Our human eyes can only see a small portion of the electromagnetic spectrum, known as visible light. There are many other types of light, like ultraviolet, UV, and infrared, IR, that are invisible to us. Some animals, like bees, can see ultraviolet light, which helps them find nectar in flowers. Mantis shrimp, on the other hand, have one of the most complex visual systems known to science, with the ability to see ultraviolet, infrared, and even polarized light. Imagine what the world must look like to them. So, while we think we have a good grasp on colors, our vision is actually quite limited. There could be countless colors beyond our perception. Some researchers are even exploring the idea of tetrachromacy in humans, a condition where people have an extra type of cone cell in their eyes, allowing them to see more colors than the average person. It's rare, but those with tetrachromacy can see subtle differences in shades that most of us can't even imagine. There's also the concept of impossible colors, like reddish-green or bluish-yellow. These colors can't be perceived under normal viewing conditions because they require the simultaneous activation of opposing color channels in our eyes. However, with special visual tricks and experimental setups, people have reported glimpsing these unusual colors, challenging our understanding of color perception. So, ancient people didn't see blue because it wasn't part of their language or culture. But don't worry, they still experienced the world in their own unique way. And who knows? Maybe in the future we'll discover new colors that are beyond our current understanding. After learning these things, we begin to understand the profound impact language has on our lives. The language we speak and the words we use are incredibly important. To those of you who have stayed with me until now, I highly recommend checking out our other video where we explain why the sky is blue. I'm sure you'll enjoy it. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel. I'm also eager to read your thoughts in the comments section. Thanks so much for sticking with me until the end of this video. Until next time, stay curious and full of energy.